Galatians 6 on sowing. So, verse 6, anyone who receives instruction in the word must share all things, all good things with his instructor. Verse 7, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Now, look at verse 8. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will be destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Is it about money? Was I reading to myself? I'm asking, is this sowing and reaping about silver and gold and shillings? No. It's about sinful behavior and righteous living. Always read the scripture in context, because the sowing and reaping here is on character. The one who, verse 8, if you are ever going to remember anything from me, it would be verse 8. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Why are we willing to sow in the Spirit? Why are we not willing? And that is the context. Now, about giving, of course, the Bible says we give generously. Generously doesn't mean you take everything. It means you give, you know, in a sacrificial way, denying yourself something. But it doesn't mean that you give until your children ask you, so what shall we eat in the evening? Does that matter?
Thank you so much, Mr. Ruben. Shall we appreciate him? I believe that this session might not answer all the questions. And that's why we're encouraging us that after this, a CU can plan their own scripture engagement forum. And we are there to guide and help see and articulate issues to be able to put them together and have these facilitators come to a direct Christian unit so that we're able to have these conversations ongoing. Allow me to invite Naomi to just come and take us from there. Let's appreciate her.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord again. God is good all the time. And that is His nature. Wow. Thank God for this day that He's enabled us to see. Now we are almost heading to our second session. Actually, we are in our second session. And I want to thank us all for taking minimum time during the break and even for settling fast. Just thank your neighbor and appreciate them for that. I have said it's time to leave and appreciate them. So I'm here to do the normal task of inviting our second facilitator, and he is in the house. We can just give the Lord a lot of applause. So the facilitator is married to one Monica, and they are blessed with four children. That is Purity, Jerry, Joy, and the other one is going to clarify if he wasn't captured. Yes, he's also a senior pastor at Mana Christian Fellowship. Yes, and I believe you already know the topic of this session, the doctrine of sin. So I want to urge us to just be attentive. If you have questions, note them down. You can also send them to that number, and you shall be blessed. So the speaker is none other than Albert Nandi. You can appreciate him as he comes. Yes, yes.
Thanks a lot, Naomi. Really appreciate our privilege being here today. As Naomi mentioned, yeah, my name is Albert Nandi. I'm married to Monica. I would like to ask Monica to come and say Chamge to us before I get going. Some of you here, she's a good Mademu. To some of you here, I can see some people going, yay! All right. Yeah, so we've been married for 27 years, and we are truly thankful to the Lord. We thank God for bringing us this far.
Good morning.
Good
morning. Chamge to us. Praise the Lord. It's a pleasure to be here, and we thank God for this forum and you being yourself here to be taught of the Word of God. That is really the most important thing. We are here on earth to obey God, to honor God, and to keep His commandments. So when we learn about His commandments, and He helps us by His grace to keep them, then we are able to honor God and to live lives that are worth living. So thank God for this opportunity. I work in a Bomete University College, and I also teach here sometimes, and that is why seeing their surfaces that are seeing a familiar face. I thank God for that. I've interacted with quite a number of students for a number of years from this place. But above all, I am happy to be a child of God, and I'm happy to be here to listen to God's word. May the Lord bless us as we hear His word. Thank you.
Yes, we are blessed with three children of our own and one adopted child. Our adopted child works in Nairobi at State House. And then that's Juliet. Juliet is her name. And we have Purity. Purity is also based in Nairobi, works as a communications officer there. Then we have Jerry, who is graduating in December. He's been studying law. And then Joy, who is also finishing sometime this month. After that, he might be positive. So, yeah, that's a little bit about my time myself. Beautiful. Today, we are going to handle the topic, you know, the doctrine of sin. The doctrine of sin. And I'm so glad to see Ruben Kigame, a good friend of mine. When I saw him, he decided to hang around. And he's trying to intimidate me by his presence, but that's all right. It's lovely to see you, Ruben, after a long time of prayers. Are with you as you venture into the new waters. All right. So the doctrine of sin, that's what we are looking at today. The doctrine of sin. You know, our contemporary permissive society does not admit such a thing as sin. You know, instead, you know, it speaks of error, you know, mistake, superstition, you know, things like those. People don't want to talk about sin. They don't want to call sin sin because that has some repercussions. When you call it sin, what is your response to it? You know, you need to do something about it. And some people will talk of, error, you know, mistake, and stuff like that. Sin is, however, a reality. It is a reality. And basically, I would like to just define it in simple terms as disobedience against God. That's what sin is all about. It is simply disobedience against God. Sin is basically, you know, doing what God does not expect you to do, of not doing what God expects you to do. You know, sin for commission and commission. And sin often manifests itself in our actions or inaction. It manifests itself in our attitudes, you know, and by nature we're just sinful. You know, yes, it may come across in our actions or inaction. God says, you shall not steal, and you end up stealing. You should not commit adultery, and you end up, you know, action. But sometimes, you know, God says something and you don't do it. It's inaction, it's still sin. And sometimes it just gets manifested in terms of our attitudes. You know, it doesn't quite sometimes come out in action, per se. But it's important also to realize that you may not do anything, or you know, you may end up not doing anything sinful, you know, action. You may end up, you know, trying to lead your life very well. You just go to bed and sleep and stuff like that, but you are still a sinner by nature. You may not do anything, but you are born in sin. We are born in sin, and we are sinners by nature. The origin of sin can be traced back to our original parents, you know, Adam and Eve, in chapter 3 of Genesis, where the fall occurs. And the Bible clearly teaches that sin is universal. The universality of sin is stressed in the scripture, that we are all sinners. Regardless of where we are, you know, you may be rich, you may be poor, you may be young or old, you may be coming from a certain background. That does not insulate, you know, insulate you from sin. You are still a sinner. Since the fall of man, sin has become, you know, an endemic feature of human existence. And so, the universality of sin has affected every area of our lives. Can I remove this a little bit? Okay, this is how I look like. All right, allow me to wear it, okay? I hope the words are coming out. I'm trying to pronounce them really slowly. I hope they are coming out. You know, so since the fall of man, really, sin became a universal problem that is touching every area of our lives, that is touching every human being around the world. Because of Adam's disobedience, sin entered the human race, and we are born, you know, in a sinful, corrupt nature. Irrespective of our condition, irrespective of our class, we are all sinners by nature, and we fall short of the glory of God. We fall short of the standard of God. We fall short of what God expects of us. Yes, the universality of sin is something that cannot be denied. Our society may not want to talk about sin. Our society may want to talk about, you know, mistakes and errors and stuff like that, but sin is a reality. And for the next few moments, I would like to look at some of, you know, the, okay, yeah, I forgot to, yeah. So sin often manifests itself in our actions, in our attitude, and in our nature. And the aspect of universality of sin that has affected every area of our lives and every single individual because of, you know, the sin of the, you know, our first parents is something that we need to keep in mind. People talk of being good. Human beings are just good by nature. Human beings are sinful. They are depraved. They are helpless in sin. Sin affects every area of our lives. And it affects us all, regardless of our standing in the society. Well, I'd like to talk a little bit about the source of sin. Tighten your seatbelt, we're going to be flying here a little bit. So the aspect of source of sin, Genesis chapter 3, is what we're going to focus on a lot. And the first source of sin I'd like us to look at is direction. The places you go, you know, the places you visit, the direction you take in life could lead you into sin. It can so easily lead you into sin. The places you go to, the people you interact with, can be the source of temptation and finally lead you to sin. In this chapter 3 of Genesis, I believe you know the story. I may not read the whole portion, but I'm going to be focusing quite a bit on that part, the whole of chapter 3, this morning. You know, in that portion of scripture, Genesis chapter 3, you know, you realize that Eve is conversing with the serpent. And in verse 3, you know, she says the following words. But God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you'll die. That's what Eve says. But God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die. It would appear to me that Eve was fairly close to the tree that was referring to. This is because later in verse 6, you know, she takes the fruit and eats it and passes it on to Adam. And you don't see her move, you know, like where she was talking initially, she was very close. The direction she had taken was the direction of the tree that was in the middle of the Garden of Eden. What did I say? You don't see her move from the conversation, you know, from where the conversation was taking place. That means she was very, very close to the tree. Perhaps she was standing close to it, admiring its beauty. Yes, she had taken direction towards the tree. And the devil meets her right there. And the temptation takes place. And finally, the fall happens. You know what, friends? Sometimes we fall into sin by simply moving in the wrong direction. Sometimes we fall into sin by just moving into the wrong direction, going to the wrong place at the wrong time, and you find yourself in trouble. It's amazing how many sins we would avoid if we just went to the right places, if we just took the right direction, if you just avoided the wrong company. It's just amazing how, you know, you would save yourself from so much trouble of temptation, you know, to sin. And friend, I want to challenge you to think seriously about some of the places you go to, some of the direction, you know, you take in life. Is that path that is going to lead to temptation? There are places you shouldn't even think of going to. And by the way, protect first years. Sometimes they are told about this bash and the other bash, and they are thinking, oh, you know, I want to be a part of that. And then they realize they're getting into trouble. Am I talking sense here? The places we go to, the direction we take, can lead to temptation and ultimately to sin. What are some of the decisions you're making? What are some of the places you're going to? What are some of the friends you've chosen to keep? You know, to keep? Who are some of those friends you've chosen to keep? What company are you keeping? What direction are you taking? Well, the second source of sin is doubt. Doubt. And in the second part of verse 1, you know, the serpent said to the woman, This is verse 1b. Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? That's the devil, that's the subject. Raising doubt in the mind of this sweet lady here. This question was meant to bring doubt about God's word. Did God really say? This question was meant to bring doubt about God's intentions. It's like, does God really intend well? Did he intend well when he said you should not? Did he really even say? The subject was suggesting the possibility that God was not fair to impose his restrictions by saying, this tree in the middle of the garden, you will not eat from it. And in verse 4 and 5, the serpent says, you will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. By this statement, Satan suggests that God was depriving the woman and her husband of some blessings than those that they were already enjoying. Doubt. Doubt. Does God really have good intentions regarding you? Does God really mean this? Did he really say? And dear ones, the devil can easily lead us to sin if he succeeds in causing us to doubt God's word. Did God really say? When you get to a point where you are asking yourself, did he really say that, I should not cheat? Did he really say everybody is cheating around? You know, the exam room, you know, everybody is sleeping around. Did God really say that I should wait until marriage? Did God really say I should not bribe? Did he really mean it? When you get to a point where you doubt, you know, an explicit command from God's word, friend, you are faced with danger and you become vulnerable to the enemy, to the temptation, and finally to sin. Never, ever doubt God's word. Believe it, hold it, live by it, you know, trust God, even when things seem to be hard. Never doubt. Because doubting God's word often leads to sin. Well, the third source of sin, the devil likes using, you know, is our desires. He takes our God-given appetites and sometimes twists them, you know, to make us feel like, oh, I must get this or I will die, you know. I must get this. I am yearning for it. My body is yearning for it. My desires, you know, are screaming for this. Satan presented temptation to Eve through God-given appetites. Verse 6 says, when the woman saw the fruit of the tree was good for food, and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, you know, desires. God given again, desires. God given appetites. She saw it was good for food. She saw that it was pleasing to the eye and desirable for gaining wisdom. Oh, she felt, okay, I will go get it. Eve gave into her desires. She looked at the tree and saw that it was good for food, pleasing to the eye, and one that could make her wise if she partook of it. But did she end up being wise? She ended up in more trouble, so to speak. She ended up in trouble. And friend, I put it to you that when God establishes rules for us to live by, He is not trying to stop us from having fun. When He establishes rules and says, don't go this direction, it's because He loves you so much, He loves me so much, that He doesn't want us to head towards destruction. You know, He does not put, you know, establish rules to take fun from us. He only asks us to leave behind what He knows can harm us and destroy our life. God does not give us rules to restrict us, but for our enjoyment. It is not like this God, oh, He does not want me to have fun. Oh, He doesn't want... No. You know, it would be... I drive around quite a bit. You know, around the country, sometimes out of the country, kidogo. And, you know, as you drive, there are these road signs that sometimes show, hey, slow down. There is a sharp bend to the right or to the left. You know, hey, slow down. There are bumps. You know, I would be a very silly young man. Do I look young? To just say, oh, these guys who, you know, designed these road signs, you know, don't want me to have fun. I just want to drive and go at 160 kilometers per hour. Regardless of how the road looks like, I want to have fun on the road. Would I be a smart boy if I did that?
No.
Are they trying to restrict my fun on the road? No, they're trying to make me safe. And that's why I try to, you know, where they ride 20 kilometers, you know, per hour, I try to go at 20. You know, 15, you know. They are trying to fall on the road rules. They are not meant to take fun from driving. They are meant to protect me. And you see, that's the same thing. When God says, do not, even when the desires feel like, it looks good, it looks desirable, and after all, He will understand. Siniko campo, siniko campus. Everybody seems to be sleeping around. Acha tu nijaribu huko tu mara moja. Hiyo mara moja inaweza kuwa ndio mwisho wako. Hello? Hiyo mara moja, thinking you are moving to a fertile green, whatever, you know, that grass that you think is green might just be growing on a seal. You never know. God does not give us rules to restrict our enjoyment. And how I pray that we shall redirect our God-given desires and appetites to honor and glorify Him.
Amen.
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 Don't use those God-given desires.
By the way, then when you get into your kingdom, remember me.
I remember the students.
Don't use those God-given desires when you get an opportunity in the political arena to eat, to amass wealth, to grab, to... You know what I mean? Come on! The amount of integrity that out there. And by the way, I challenge you guys, when you come out, join the politics and let's leave this country. Some of you, if you think the anointing of God to join the political circle, in here, done, kabisa, put up support. That's the only way we can change this country. So that we use our God-given desires not to grab and destroy other lives, but to help other lives pick up and become better. Oh yes, I challenge us to, you know, be risk takers a bit. Oh yes, friends, if we are to overcome sin, we need to be careful about the direction we take. We also need to be careful and guard against doubting God's word. And we also need to redirect our desires to honor and glorify God. Allow me now to look at the consequences of sin. The consequences of sin. I'm still going to be focusing on Genesis chapter 3. You can follow that easily on PowerPoint. Yeah. The consequences of sin. The first consequence of sin we see in Genesis chapter 3 is the aspect of
shame. Sin brings shame. Sin brings shame. Verse 7 says, then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made a covering for themselves. They were ashamed of their nakedness when they realized they were naked, and they tried to make some fig coverings for themselves. By the way, this was the first cover-up in human history. Cover-up did not begin with the Watergate scandal. It began in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve, you know, took leaves to cover themselves. Sin brings shame. And that's why, even as a country, by the way, I believe we should really defer. When I was born, by the way, and I started knowing things around the Irogu, I started hearing things like, you know, politicians talk, and they would say this is early 70s, and they would say something like, you know, nitalete maji, nitalete stima, nitajenga barabara. You know, I'm in my 50s now. I still hear them, they're saying the same thing. Nitalete stima, nitalete maji. Excuse me. You know, as a country, we are so blessed with many resources, but corruption has chewed these resources away and made us, you know, as calm in this, you know, in the society, so to speak. People look at us thinking, hey, you know, you people should be so far. Look at you. And there are places I'm ashamed to be a Kenyan. Oh, yes. Sometimes, you know, when you're out there and people are talking about our leads and stuff like that, and you are like, yes, I'm a Kenyan. But sometimes they bring some topics, you're like, sin brings shame. You know, that's why, you know, corruption has chewed at our resources and stuff like that. And we are ashamed sometimes even to identify with our nation. I mean, we got independence around the same time in Singapore, you know, and stuff like that. And we are still a third world country, a developed country. If we are not careful, by the way, we shall soon be a 10th world country. Sin has brought shame to us. Corruption and stuff like that. Sin brings shame. Dear ones, when you sin, especially as a child of God, when you blow it up and compromise, you don't feel like it. Do you feel like that? You feel like that. Eve was ashamed that they made coverings for themselves. And by the way, only God can really truly cover us. Our futile attempts to cover ourselves won't work. Only God, through the blood of Jesus, can cover our nakedness fully. Well, sin also brings, you know, a sense of phlegm. I'll use this word phlegm to stand for a sense of guilt, fear, sense of trepidation. This is another consequence of sin. Sin brings a sense of phlegm. God, fear, you know. Verse 8 to 10 says, the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man, where are you? He answered, verse 10, I heard you in the garden and I was afraid. I had a sense of guilt. There was, my conscience was, you know, not right. A sense of flame, guilt, fear. You know, I heard you in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. Sin brings a sense of guilt burning inside, flame. No wonder I'm using the word flame in that. You know, you do not feel great when you fall into sin unless your conscience is totally seared. And we have people whose conscience is totally seared.
in this verse, you know, it's a shame that the garden, which was once a place of joy and fellowship with God, becomes a place of fear and hiding from God. There's so much sense of flame in them that they don't want to have fellowship with God anymore. They are feeling guilty. Sin brings a sense of flame. It brings a sense of fear. It brings a sense of guilt. If people knew the consequences of sin, really, there would be very few partakers of sin. But people take sin so easily. You know, well, another consequence of sin is blame. Blame. By now you know where I'm headed, yeah? Trying to end all those words with M. All right, it brings a sense of shame, flame, blame. Okay? Easy to remember that. And the first one, the first aspect, the three D's, what were they? Okay, I assume you don't say the right thing. Okay, yeah, so there's a sense of blame. This is another consequence of sin. Look at verse 11 to 13. In verse 11 to 13, God asks, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? Then the man says in verse 12, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it. Blame them, that's. You know, have you eaten? Oh, yeah, God, the woman. It's like, God, I am not really responsible. You are to blame her. If you created this woman here, she wouldn't have eaten and tempted me. Blame, 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 blame. And this still continues today. Blame game. A merry-go-round of blame game. Verse 13, then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. But I'm reading from the New International Version, the 1984 edition. Okay, that's the one I'm using. Yeah, so the Lord God says to the woman, what is this you've done? The woman says, the serpent deceived me. So the man says, the woman is the problem, blame them. The woman says, the serpent is the problem. And the blame game continues. The man blamed the woman blamed the serpent. The serpent had no legs to stand on, unfortunately. Sin impels us to blame others for our disobedience. But God still holds us personally accountable for what we do. Oh, hatujafikia hiki na hiki na hiki kwa sababu ya corona. Blame! You blame it on everything. Oh, hatujafanya hiki na hiki kwa sababu ya wakoloni. I mean, excuse me, tumekuwa independent for how long? Bado una blame colonialists? Excuse me, am I hearing you right, Mr. Politician? I mean, stop blaming people, pick yourself up, take responsibility! You know, instead of, you know, taking the situation on squarely, they go get into a merry-go-round of blame game. And this is what we often do when we seek to blame others for our failures. But instead of blaming others, you know what we need to own up? We need to turn to God and ask for forgiveness. Blaming others will never help or exempt you from the consequences of sin. It will never. Oh, alinidanganya. Akanifanyia hivi. Ulidanganywa really? Do you know what the word of God says? Sasa hata mtu akikudanganya si unajua huyu ni mwongo. Blame, 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 blame. Blame. Sin brings shame. Sin brings a sense of flame, guilt. Sin brings a sense of blame. And lastly, it makes us lame. It makes us ineffective, It paralyzes us, and we become less of what God intended of us. It makes us lame. You know, this has the idea of being less than what God intended of us. Being less effective. Bless you, Brother Ruben. Thank you for staying. Yeah, he insisted on staying for a few moments. Yeah, at least, which is great. In verse 16 to 19, we see that sin, in a way, made Adam and Eve ineffective, lame. You know, if you remember these words, shame, flame, blame. You know? These are the consequences of sin. This is how bad sin is. In verse 16 to 19, we see the results of their sin. You know, as a result of their sin, God pronounces a curse on them. They were meant to lead a lovely life that was full, you know, of fruitfulness of speech to the Lord, but they are not living it to the maximum. They are not maximizing on their potential. They have been made lame because of sin. As I say, this aspect of lame has the idea of being less than what God intends us to be, being less effective, not being all that God wants you to be. And this is what happens when we sin. In verse 22 to 24, there's a sense of separation, you know, from God as he banishes Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden. Initially, God wanted to have fellowship with them. That was the complete life, but now it's lame. God says, out of my garden, no more fellowship. That's what sin does. It makes us lame. It makes us ineffective. It kind of makes us just less than what God intended us to be. They are banished from the garden that they were supposed to be taken care of. They become lame. They are not all that God wants them to be. Folks, when we sin, we become lame. You know, our love for God grows cold. Our fellowship with him is disrupted. And our fruitfulness in ministry is damaged. That is why we should take sin seriously. It just incapacitates you. Somebody who would be very vibrant for the Lord, making an impact for him, is rendered in a way ineffective because of sin. Somebody who should be doing exploits for the Lord becomes lame. They cannot be effective for Jesus. They cannot have the impact they need to have for the kingdom because they have been made lame by sin. Adam and Eve were meant to have continuous fellowship with the Lord. It was cut because of sin. They were supposed to take care of the garden. They are banished from the garden. They were supposed to live a blessed life. And now they have to contend with curses. You know, curses upon Eve, curse upon Adam, curse upon the serpent. This made them lame. Sin is harmful to our lives, friends, and it's destructive to others, also who are around us. It's not just destructive to us, but to others. When we sin, we become lame. We're not effective as family members, you know. You're not an effective son or daughter because maybe you are so much into drugs or this or that. It makes you lame. You're not an effective, you know, student. It makes you less than what you would have gotten, you know, maybe you need to maximize your potential, be the best you can be. But sin can just make you lame, that you don't even realize your full potential as a man of God, as a husband, as a businessman, as a politician, whatever you are. It makes you less than what you should be. And that's why we need to take sin very seriously. Friends, sin is serious. Disobedience against God is serious, whether it is, you know, through our acts, our attitudes, it is serious business. Let's treat sin with the seriousness that we need to treat it. Yes, the consequences of sin are shame, flame, blame, and blameless. I'd like now to move to the last part of my presentation and talk about victory over sin. The aspect of victory over sin. And I'm going to be focusing on Revelation chapter 2, verse 4 and verse 5 as we wind up our talk this morning. Victory over sin. It's lovely to know that with the fall of man, God, you know, promised a redeemer right from Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. You know, when he said, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers, he will crush your head and you will strike his heel. Actually, this was a prophecy that was fulfilled about 4,000 years later at Calvary, when Jesus was at, you know, the seed of a woman, crushed the head of the serpent, so to speak, and made it possible for us to live in victory over sin. And so we can't just sit there and say, oh, poor me. Oh, Adam and Eve sinned. We would just be walking in the Garden of Eden and having fruit and enjoying life. These people, they really messed our lives. Oh, you know, blame again. They blame them. We can't just sit there and blame them. We should be thankful for a solution that is found in Christ Jesus, who can redeem us from the curse of the law, who can give us victory over sin. Hallelujah. Amen. Thankfully, you know, thank God for the seed of the woman, that we can have victory over sin. In Christ, we have victory over sin, and we can lead holy lives by God's grace. And if we fall in sin, you know, we should turn to the Lord. There are people who have this strange teaching that, you know, since I have been born again, you know, I can just live the kind of life I want to live. You know, it doesn't matter my past, sins, present, and future are all forgiven. I can be careless. You can't be careless. Amen. Hello? Amen. You cannot afford to be careless. You have victory over sin. You can live in victory. You know, it's like Albert Gandhi being a little bit silly and saying, you know, I am now married to Monica. I am married. It doesn't matter how I live my life as long as I'm married. I can just go out and come late at night or come in the morning. I can just mistreat my kids and my wife. It doesn't matter how I live. After all, I'm married. Excuse me? Would it be silly to do that? Yes, married I am. But I have to... How do I put it? Make it sound a bit scriptural. I have to work on my marriage with fear and trembling. I can't just say, I'll be careless. You know? No, I have to treat this girl nice. I see. You know, I have to be a servant to God and serve her where I can. Can't just be a typical real man who sits in the sitting room and I'm going to try. You're trying for diary. No, I have to be a servant. And instead of going, sometimes I have to prepare tea. I have to ask her, would you like a cup of tea? Ipo kazi kukiona mbelea bwana we, vimefanya nini? Vimeungwa vijajiunda. Ukiona mbelea vimefanya nini? Kuna kazi fulani. Wezi kuwa tu careless kuseme, it doesn't matter how many other women I hang around, I am married after all. Would that marriage work? And aren't we sometimes so silly when we follow some of these extreme teachings and go, Now that I have given my life to Jesus, I can live the way I want. I can just live, you know, easy that yet and if I am nimesamehewa. Excuse me? Really? Umesamehewa ndio, but you need to work on your salvation with fear and trembling. And that's why when you sin, when you fall in sin, oh thank God, we have Christ who is there. You know who is our advocate, you know? And if you confess of our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so when you fall, when you slide and fall, don't just think there and say, oh, poor me. Nime teleza nikaanguka. Oh, poor me. You would be a fool to just stay down there kwa mapepe. You need some help to anguka. Sipanguza. And get going again. Amen. Ukiteleza, usikae tu pale usema, oh, huwa mimi maisha ya Kristo ni ngumu. Alinidanganya nikakubali. Sasa, amka! Dust yourself up and get going. We have an advocate. We can go to Christ and say, hey, Jesus, forgive me, cleanse me, purify me, make me whole. And, you know, you make things right and get going again. Usibaki hapo tunakaa ndee kwa dhambi unakafua. Kwa dhambi aso una enjoy. If we fall, you know, there are three clear commands that I would like to touch on from this passage of scripture that, you know, the church at Ephesus, you know, are instructed to follow. And the first command that can enable us to have victory over sin is to remember. It's important to remember. It's important to remember where you've come from. It's important to remember the height from which you have fallen. Sometimes when, you know, you feel like you are being overcome by sin, victory is guaranteed. But we need to remember. Revelation chapter 2, verse 4 and 5 says, yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. These people at the church in Ephesus have forsaken their first love. And you may feel like, oh, I have blown it up. I just did something I shouldn't do. I have forsaken my first love, oh God. Here's the remedy. Verse 5. Let me start at verse 4 again. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. Verse 5, remember the height from which you have fallen. Remember the height from which you have fallen. It is important to call to mind, you know, the very beginning of grace. Remember where you are. When you fall in sin, it's important to remember where you were before that happened. It's important to remember God's goodness to you, God's faithfulness to you in the past, God's mercies to you in the past. You know, you need to remember that because it helps you keep things in perspective. You realize the joy of salvation is gone. David realized the joy of salvation was gone when he sinned. And he says, you know, he remembers and he says, you know, restore unto me the joy of your salvation. You know, remember where you are. Remember God's grace, God's goodness. When your walk with him was vibrant, it's important to remember where you come from. You know, when you remember, it helps you keep things in perspective. And you realize, oh, look, my walk with the Lord isn't as vibrant as it was. There's something that happened, this thing. No, it can't be this way. And you make the right move. You know, it's important to really remember where you come from. I don't know how many of you remember your backgrounds. You know, some of you come to college from very simple, poor backgrounds. Then you get into wrong company because you've forgotten where you are here. And you can, you know, just forget and get lost. It's important to remember where you come from. Hello? Because that will motivate you to keep things in perspective. And when you fall in sin, remember how vibrant your walk was with the Lord. Remember what you're missing, that connection. Remember the fact that you've been made lame, not as effective as you need to be. You know, and that will help you make things right. You know, I really cherish shoes, by the way. I really cherish shoes. I napenda viatu. You know why? I come from a very poor, humble background. And sikuvaa viatu mpaka nilipokuwa naenda. I have a new pair of shoes, my first new pair of shoes, when I was doing form 5, form 6. Those days. But this is missing this hand. Nikiongea kuhusu hiyo system ya form 5, form 6. You know? My first new pair of shoes when I was getting for five. Yani unatembea chini, mguu. Mpaka mguu na pasuko unaweza kuingiza shilingi tano huko chini. Alafu vile vianda vya mguu vimekaa hivi. They don't want to have fellowship. I take for a fellowship hivi. Kwa sababu unavaa viatu viko hivi. By the way, bado kuna gap. Mpaka sasa hivi. Ali wear shoes for a while. Anyway, just remembering my background helps put things in perspective and helps me appreciate shoes. When you remember where you have fallen, it makes you appreciate where you need to be. I don't take things for granted. Hello? You know, I'd say that many marriages wouldn't be breaking today if the spouses could simply, you know, remember their first love. If they just remember their first love, many marriages wouldn't be breaking today. Hello? That day when he's reason, I think of my first love in the Kumbuka group. You know, there are those days I would yawn, I go, Monica would ask, sweetie, are you okay? Just yawning. This place I sneeze, I go, yeah! She doesn't even notice! I think of first love, we need to remember where we come from, I guess. Well, the second command that will enable us to have victory over sin is to repent. It is important to remember. But just remembering is not enough. We need to repent. Back to Revelation chapter 2, verse 4 and 5. Yet I have, verse 4 and 5 here. Yet I have this against you. You have forsaken your first love. Remember the height from which you have fallen. Then the second part there is repent. That's the word there. Remember the height from which you've fallen. Then repent. Repent. You know, repentance means turning or changing one's mind. It is a change of mind that results in a change of action and direction. Change of mind that results in change of action and direction. Actually, true repentance is better captured by, you know, the following military command. Maybe you are walking towards this direction. The military command is halt. So you about turn. Quick forward march. You are heading in the wrong direction, basically. And repentance is like, halt, don't keep going, stop. About turn. Quick forward march to the right direction. That is what repentance is. You realize you have had a vibrant walk with the Lord, but all of a sudden you are going to the right wrong direction. You need to halt. Don't keep going. You will perish. About turn. Quick forward march towards the right direction. You know, that is what you need to do. You realize this is not the kind of life I'm supposed to be leading. You know, as a Christian, I'm not supposed to be leading this way. I will stop this life of immorality. I will turn back and I will go towards Christ. I will not continue in this, you know, talk of corruption. I will stop. I will turn and go towards the right direction. I will not continue doing what everybody else seems to be doing. I'm gonna stop. Even if I'm the only one, I will turn around and do the right thing. That is what repentance is all about. It's more than just feeling remorseful for something you have done. It's more than just, you know, being sorry for being caught. You know, there are people who are sorry for being caught. I'm sorry because you are caught in sin. You're not sorry for the sin, you're sorry for being caught. I mean, it's about being sorry, stopping, moving to the right direction. We have victory in Jesus. And through him, we can stop. He can give us the power to stop moving in the wrong direction, turn around to our Maker, to have fellowship with him, to have a vibrant walk with him, to be effective in ministry for him, to be effective in life for him, to change the nation of Kenya for him. Hallelujah. Amen. We can turn around because victory is ours in Christ Jesus. And the last command that will enable us to have victory over sin is the idea of returning. I think I've demonstrated this very well here. You know, again, back to Revelation chapter 2, verse 4 and 5. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. Remember, verse 5 again, remember the height from which you have fallen. Remember, it's important to call to mind. It's important to recall. Remember the height from which you have fallen. Repent. And lastly, do the things you did at first. Other version says, return to the things you did at first. You know, do the things you did at first. Return to what you have forsaken. You are going to the wrong direction. You turn around and return to your vibrant walk with the Lord. Do the things you did at first has the idea of returning to the things that made you feel closer to the Lord. What are some of the things you did at first when your relationship with the Lord was vibrant? Are you still doing them? How I pray that we shall all return to the honeymoon period of our love for God. The real point about, you know, our first love is to have undivided and an equivocal, you know, love for God. And do the things that, you know, please him. The things that honor and glorify him. And friend, my question to you is, are you struggling with sin in any way? Do you feel like your walk with the Lord is not as vibrant as it ought to be? Then, remember where you have fallen from, repent, and return to your first love. Victory over sin is guaranteed in Christ Jesus. Will you take it? Or do you continue just lying there and saying, oh, poor me, and blaming others, having a sense of shame, being lame and some like that, being incapacitated? How I pray that we shall be a people who endeavor to lead holy lives, obeying God in our actions, in our deeds, in our attitudes. And that we shall be a people who will help others who are struggling with sin to overcome sin. Amen. Amen. Friend, don't play with sin. Sin is serious. I do a bit of counseling also. And one of the things that is so painful is talking to people who are having to pay for the sins of their parents, so to speak. This person has messed up his life, he dies. And the children are left to deal with so much mess. Sin has terrible consequences, friends. Sin is bad. Sin is terrible, and we should avoid it as a plague. Victory is guaranteed in Christ Jesus. Lord, I pray for these demons that they would take sin with the seriousness it deserves. They would avoid it. Thank you that victory is ours in Christ Jesus. Thank you that, Lord, we can overcome because you overcame. Hallelujah. Is the Lord bringing to mind that in your prayer? Is the Lord bringing to mind maybe a sin that you need to confess? Something that is holding you back and making you ineffective, lame. Take this moment and just pray before the Lord in your heart and say, and just square it out with Him. Tell Him, Lord, I surrender this to you. This sin that easily, you know, holds me, this encumbrance, Lord, I surrender it to you. Take it all, Lord, and give me victory. Forgive me, Lord, and give me a brand new day from today of starting to walk in victory. Oh yes, this is that God moment. When the Lord is confronting and saying, deal with this, deal with this. Please go ahead and just respond to the Lord in your heart. Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Jesus, that we have victory in you over sin. And it's therefore now no condemnation to us who are in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, help us to begin see sin for what it is and avoid it. Help us to love you, live for you, and honor you. And when we fail, Lord, help us to rush back to you in repentance. Lord, I pray for these dear ones and those who are watching us wherever, from wherever, that Lord would give them victory over sin. In Jesus' name. And everybody say,
praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. Let us appreciate Pastor Albert for that wonderful time. This victory over sin is guaranteed for us in Christ Jesus. And I hope you have listened carefully. Thank you, such a wonderful speaker that you cannot even get tired listening to. So sad that we have to come to an end, but I hope that you have captured all this. And let us to share our questions, even as we continue to respond. Have a few, anyone who has a question that would like to voice it over? The speaker? Yes.
When you talk about sin, you have the right thing and the good thing. When you talk about the good thing, let me say an example. You have a friend who takes tobacco, and you know he cannot go a full day without taking it. So he asks you for money. He doesn't have money, and you, what will you do? You give him the money to buy the tobacco, and then. The next question is about separation. We've talked about marriage. Their marriage is you're married, and your companion is making you suffer, and you can avoid it by, you can go back home. Not divorcing, but you go back home. Is it sin? About culture. You have some cultural activities back back at home that you cannot avoid as a kid when you are still young. Your parents control you, so when you grow up, there are cultural activities that you must undergo when you're still young. So how can you convince the parents that you don't want to go through them? And when you talk, most especially us youths, when you are talking, and then let's say just that you react. Sema kama umechemsha maji kwa moto alafu shike ukichome na washa unasema fuck man, no, is it sin or and how can you avoid it? I think
praise God. As for me, I have three questions. I think they are not so much difficult. Number one, do you have to confess your sins out loud to a pastor or a religious leader for you to be forgiven, as we are seeing this happen in some churches? Then number two, can our prayers change God's mind or God's will? For example, we know that the result of sin is death, or at least there is punishment. And if we confess, can this change the past situation of God's will, or do we still have to be punished for what we had already done? And then lastly, the case when one is a Christian and his or her death comes or catches him or her in that sin. Maybe you have lived as a Christian, you are born again, and then you have, as we know that man is a sin, and like sometimes you just find yourself in sin. So if you die in that situation, like do you still have a chance to go to heaven because of your faith, or now this sin will now lead you to go to hell because that is where your death came in? Because you know after death you don't have time to confess. Thank you.
Thank you for those questions. I hope I got them right. There was that aspect of giving a friend money for tobacco or something. I think one of the things I do not want to do is to facilitate, you know, the wrong lifestyles of people. And this is partly why I have partnered with some children who and stuff like that. I don't give my money, for example, to street kids. I'd rather buy them banana or food or something. So you do not want to facilitate, but you don't have to befriend them. I want them in a secure place, a children's home somewhere. So if you just give them money, you are basically facilitating their blue culture, you know, their band culture in the streets and stuff like that. And so I would say there are moments when somebody sobers up, when they realize they don't have the money and you're not kind of financing a lifestyle that is wrong. Does that make sense? So it's okay to say no. However, a friend, I was just dealing with this, a similar question. A friend was saying, my father drinks himself silly, you know, and all the money I give sometimes, you know, so do I give him money still? And I said, yeah, it's part of honoring your parents. That's up to him and his God. But for money that you want to feel like you are, you know, it's going into helping the family, please give mama or somebody that can manage it well. So when it comes to parents, it's different. It's a little bit different, I would say. It depends on the context. Although by and large, I would just say, do not help facilitate a wrong lifestyle, by and large. Okay? And especially when it's a friend, you can just say, no, I'm not going to give you money for bank, stuff like that. Marriage is a bit tricky sometimes, but you know what? Some of these things, you can avoid them by just choosing the right partner. Wait upon the Lord, pray, and look at somebody, know them, study them, know them well. If you do that, about 90% of the problems will be taken care of. But you just meet somebody because anaba longi, not every mutu mwenye anaba longi anaweza kuwa husband yako anyway. Ama amevaa skirt, ama ni beautiful. Unasema yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, then you get into trouble when you realize the character aspect. And by the way, as a counselor, I tell somebody, I tell people, you are not to, you're nobody's punching bag. And there are moments I actually ask people to walk out and help solve the problem when they are not in the situation, because they may be killed in that situation. But I would just say, this doesn't have a very direct answer, but I would say, angalia vizuri. In Luyaland, you know, when I was taking this Mrembo home, before I took her, as high school teacher then, she was still, you know, and then I took her, Mama Inuliza. In Luyaland, I said, why Ngabulai? Why no Ngabulai? So I will ask you, I'm a Munyore, they come from Vihiga, the people who aim higher. I am one of those people from aim higher constituency. So, Ngabulai. But then when it gets to a point where it's a life and death issue, there are moments when I advise you see a counselor, and a counselor may advise for temporary separation as things are sorted out. But there are extreme situations that actually it's okay to let go, to be honest. I know that is hard for me to say as a pastor, but the counselor in me, I'm wearing several hats. It's sometimes just to a point where it's important to let go. Cultural activities. We are sometimes engaged in a cultural thing, and maybe you are sure it doesn't honor God. So how do you stand up against your parents and say no? I think sometimes when you are mudogo, you may not be able to speak. But as you grow up, you can talk respectfully and say, Dad, this makes me a bit uncomfortable. And you know, you can respectfully look for a way. And if it's not really being registered, maybe use another relative, maybe an uncle or an auntie that is a Christian or shares your value, that can talk to Papa or Mama and possibly help out in a respectful way. You don't have to rebel and, you know, throw tantrums and whatever. There are ways that we can find to handle some of these things in a wise way. Okay? Yeah. And then there was something to do with, language, foreign language. I think that should not come from our mouths. And, you know, the best thing is to interact with the Word. The more you read the Word of God, the more it sticks in you, the more you speak it out. So instead of driving and getting to a, I'm carrying something. Even some people are riding in the car and I feel like, I'm the one driving. They are the ones screaming. Oh, no, me, what is it? I'm thinking, just to hear, when I mean, I'm polite. But out of the abundance of the heart, so train your heart to be deeply circulated in the Word of God. So that what comes out when, you know, you are a bit annoyed, maybe it's God help. You know, it's not zingai. Okay? So just get soaked in the Word and train your mouth, train your words with the Word of God, really. That's the best way. Get into the Word. And that's what will come out of the abundance of God. But I also know people have come from vulgar backgrounds, and it takes time for them to grow and, you know, mature. And I give them time usually to grow. But after some time, I'm like, hey, you should be a teacher now and you're still behaving like a marafunzi of the Word. You know what I mean? Yeah, so there is growth. But mutu akishaokoka atakuwa na foreign language. I was just talking to somebody who left prison three weeks ago. Left prison on Thursday. I'm meeting him on Sunday, meeting him on Monday. Oh, the language. Came to church, God said, yeah, and you have to bear with them and listen, you know, help them. How does it grow? That will be something. Then there was something to do with confession. If we confess our sins, God is faithful to forgive us. And you do not necessarily need to confess to a priest. You have, you know, immediate access to a high priest, Jesus. You know, our mediator. You can go to him and just say, Lord, you know what you did a few moments ago when we bowed our heads? And, you know, you just talked to God. I believe God has sorted that out. I believe you have a blotted past. You don't have to come and say, you know what? You know, I killed yesterday. As long as we confess direct from their heart and repent to the Lord, he forgives. You don't have to go necessarily through somebody. There are different teachings going around, but you don't have to do that. Sort it out with the Lord. There was something to do with prayers. Do prayers change God? Did I get that right? After confession, can your prayers change God's mind? Hey, if you misbehave and you become pregnant, no matter how much you pray, the pregnancy will grow. You will give birth after 9 months. It's just God, the way God designed things. Will God forgive you when you go to him and say, Lord, forgive me for getting involved in immorality? Will he? Even as the pregnancy still grows? Oh yes, he will! Will the pregnancy stop? That is not what God, how God designed things. It will still grow. You misbehave, you get HIV infected, and there are students, as we track with students and teach college students sometimes, they come, they are okay, they graduate with a degree and HIV. Which is unfortunate. Where God is really where? God is really where Yesu. Okay. That's what I was saying. The consequences of our sins still remain. You know, that is why, you know, the curse that was spoken to Adam and Eve, you know, still has effect. The consequences still remain, but forgiveness is guaranteed. So prayer does not change God. By the way, no amount of prayer, even the fasting for 40 days, 80 days, whatever, you know, prayer changes us. It changes our attitudes. It doesn't change God. Hello? Okay, I think I need to explain that a little bit more as some other form. But basically, the consequences still remain even after you confess. Hello? But what you can still make right, maybe you do it up and pray. You need to go sometimes and talk to them and ask for forgiveness and sort it out. It's okay. But prayers do not change the consequences of our sin. Okay, there was also something about dying in sin. You know, somebody comes to the Lord and then they later rebel against the Lord or something, if I got it right, and they end up dying in sin. And sometimes it's very hard to judge. I have this person who, by the way, did not want anything to do with God, but when he was on his sickbed, you know, he prayed to receive Jesus just last minute. A lecturer who just didn't believe in these things, Mambe Mze God, Banai, Mambe Nanandi, you know. And yet on his deathbed, he receives Jesus. You know, and he's changed and transformed. There are those others who may also be in rebellion, but last minute, they just turn to the Lord. They are forgiven. Yeah, so I would say that only God can really know what somebody, you know, what situation somebody was in as they were coming, you know, home, as they were dying. But basically, the greatest gift that we have is that of receiving Jesus in our lives, because that enables us to have eternal life that is in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Alright, when an infant child is baby dies without sharing the gospel, will it be judged by God? Yes, one. Can you clarify on that? Then the other question we have on righteousness versus sin. The fact that we have been made righteous by Christ Jesus. Somebody saying that, are we still supposed to repent despite the fact that we have been made righteous by God and such conversations? Then the other one is on is sin and death, sickness and death in our families as a result of the sin that they committed, or something of the sort.
Okay. There are things that I think we may never know until we get to the other side. What has been revealed to us is what is ours. And so, when it comes to an infant, really, the infant hasn't gotten to that point of making decisions. You know, that, you know, they can make decisions either to live for God or reject it. They are not at that point. And I think some of those things just belong to God. But in my view, and again, different theologians have different views on this, a child, we are all born in sin. No other David says, you know, I was born in sin right from my, you know, I was conceived in sin. But it gets to that point where you have to make up your mind to seek Jesus or reject him. And infants, you know, haven't gotten to that place, really. And that's why the school of thought that believes that these are like little angels, you heard of that, that God just accepts and, you know, embraces as his children, because they haven't gotten to that point. And then there's something to do with the righteous, I related that. Righteousness versus sin. Yeah, we are the righteousness of God by accepting Jesus. You know, he, Christ became sin so that, you know, we who are sinners can become the righteousness of God. And so, yeah, we are the righteousness of God. But does that mean we can just live careless lives? Again, my example of marriage. Yes, you're married. But does that just mean you can mistreat your spouse and blah, blah, blah? No. Yes, we are the righteousness of God. And we need to walk in that righteousness. Honor God. Glorify him. Obey him. And when you fall in sin, by adventure, you know, you get into sin, turn back to the Lord immediately. Repent. Yes, we are the righteousness of God, but we continually need to make things right with God. Working out our salvation with fear and trembling, so to speak. So you realize you've blown it up, just go back to the Lord and say, thank you that I'm your righteousness, Lord. And thank you for the forgiveness I have in Christ Jesus. And Lord, just cleanse me and purify me from all this sin. I confess of it right now. It doesn't mean that you're righteous and you cannot confess. Does that make sense? You're righteous, and so it doesn't matter how you live. You don't have to confess anymore. You're righteous, but we're still living in a fallen world with its temptations. And as I said, sin is not necessarily just commission and omission. You know, not doing what God expects you to do. Or, you know, disobeying what he has commanded you to do. It's more than that. Sometimes it's in attitudes. You know, no wonder Jesus talks about, you know, if you look at a woman lustfully, you know. And even the Ten Commandments, you know, those that it says don't marry, but there's that of do not covet your neighbors, you know, attitude. But even if it's not in action or attitude, as I said, we are naturally, you know, the idea of the universality of sin that, you know, we are living in because our first parents sinned. And so we need to, as much as we are the righteousness of God, we need to continually go before the Lord. When the Lord convicts us of sin, we just square it out with him. Hello? And then something to do with sickness and death in family. This is another controversial area, by the way. Maybe it should be tackled very, you know, as an independent thing. I think this links well with the so-called generational blessings and generational curses. Hello? And so some people believe, oh, the sickness in the family because my, you know, great-great-grandfather, Aliwamutu, or something like that. Or, you know, there are people who are very, you know, they specialize in this, they say, you must go back to history and deal with the roots. You must know your background and go to the roots. But you know, I don't buy that school of thought much. I stand for what I do. You know, I believe that there are moments you cannot go back to history and know what your great-great-grandfather did. I believe you can just come to Christ and say, Lord, here I am, a sinner, cleanse me, purify me, make me whole. And you know, he blots out your past and gives you a new life. For anybody who is in Christ Jesus, it's a new creation. The old has gone, behold, everything is new. So I am not very strong when it comes to that generational thing and dealing with it. Yes, what you know, if there's any string that you see, a pattern, you need to probably prayerfully consider a pattern in the family. You are seeing this and this. This happened to grandfather. It happened to my dad. It's happening to my brother. You know, you may want to pray and commit that to the Lord. But really, do not associate everything. Otherwise, you become a captive of the past. And then you render the blood of Jesus useless. I mean, is the power of God more than the power that my so-called, you know, grandfather who was probably a witch? You know, is the power of Christ more than that? Hello? Or is the power of witchcraft more than the power of Christ? Sometimes we glorify the power of the enemy much when we associate our challenges and our problems with things to do with the past all the time. I know I'm raising more controversy than but that was also part of my intention. So there are sicknesses and that may come as a result of things, and maybe, you know, genetical things. We need to pray about that, or habitual things that flow down the line. But do not be held captive by what your great grandfather did, what your father did, what your auntie does, what your mother does. Hello? And I'm done. Yeah, I'm done. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. There are so many questions coming in, and because of time, let us to continue this conversation in our series, right? Because we start here, so many questions are streaming in. Please keep them coming. The number is still on. This will help us to maybe address it to the discipleship committee or our leaders in the executive committee in our series. Then you can also arrange a specific forum for this. And if one series is holding another forum, you can also invite all of us to attend. That's all. Because time is not on our side to address all these questions. Thank you very much. I'd like to welcome Naomi. Let us appreciate. Like,
it gives us why. Why do we need to have Commission 21, the Commission Conference? Yes. I don't believe you can see. Yes, I'll just use my device here. Yes, so the aim for Commission 21, Commission Conference 2021, is to preserve ongoing mission awareness, responsiveness, and involvement among Christian students, graduates, and churches. Yes, to go on to the next slide. Yes, why attend Commission Conference? Yes, the first reason why you should is to discover God's mission and responsibility in it. Yes. The second reason, to be trained and mobilized towards lifestyle evangelism. Lifestyle evangelism in the sense that your life itself speaks for you. Lifestyle evangelism, the way you live. Somebody else can just look at you and they're like, I want to be like this person. Yes. The third reason, to get a positive attitude towards mission. Yes. Not everyone goes for missions with open hands. And remember, it's for specific people. But missions is for everyone, for all of us. Yes, that is the call according to Matthew. Matthew, yes, that go ye and make disciples in my name. Yes. To be mobilized towards integral stroke, holistic missions. Yes, so being a missionary does not necessarily mean being on the ground and like maybe serving one-on-one to the least rich people group through prayers, through support and finances. Mission requires a lot of resources, and if you can be of any help in any area, you'll be part of a mission. Are we together? Yes. Number five, to be linked and connected to missionary organizations, agencies, churches, Bible schools for growth and involvement. Yes, that is also another reason. I believe it's the last reason. Yeah, why you should attend Commission Conference. So it is going to equip us with a lot of things. Samasawa. Yes, on to the next slide, the key aspects of Commission 2021. Yes, the first aspect is the platform. Yes, the Commission 21 conference is going to be virtual. It won't be happening as it has used to be. We used to meet in Gabara for a whole week. Yes, but this time due to COVID and the large numbers, we'll only be doing it virtual. Yes, the platform for the commission will be virtual. Yes, and the theme for the conference is a gospel transforming a dynamic world. Yes. Yes, the theme. A gospel transforming a dynamic world. Yes. And the next is the date. The date for the conference is 30th October to 14th November. Yes, will be for 2 weeks, that is from 30th October to 14th November. Yes, and the charges for the commission conference is 300 shillings. Yes, that's on the next slide. Yes, 300 shillings, those are the charges, and the registration for the conference the registration is on conferences.focuskenya.org. So if you have not registered, kindly visit that site today, conferences.focuskenya.org. Yes, and you'll register and pay 300 shillings. It's so cheap compared to the 5,000 they used to pay earlier and the commission, the conference was live one-on-one. Yes, so on to the next slide, please. Yes, the thrust. Yeah, so the force, or what is propelling this conference. First, the content of the gospel. It is going to help us answer what is the gospel, as our slide is telling us. Another one, the carriers of the gospel. And it is going to help us answer questions like, what defines the messenger entrusted to share the gospel in this age? Yes, another one is contemporary issues and realities, the gospel and technology, the gospel and poverty. Yes, so those are some of the things that are going to be addressed in this conference for all those things. Yes, on to the next slide. That is the Commission 21 program structure. Yes, the structure. Yes, thank you so much. Yes, also we'll be having pre-summit sessions. Pre-summit sessions will run from the 30th of October all through until the 12th. The final summit will be on 12th to 14th. That is the weekend, the last weekend to the conclusion of the conference. Then there's the 25-day challenge. It is also going to be there. Yes. On to our second last slide. That is the Commission 21 program. Commission 21 program. Yes. The program is very friendly. So it will begin on Saturday, the 30th of October. Yes, with the plenary one, that is a plenary session from 9 a.m. to 12 noon. The topic for that session will be the gospel amidst crisis. Then on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, that is first, third, and fifth, we'll have seminar session one, seminar session two, seminar session three. And as you can see, the time is very favorable. It's 7:30 to 4 p.m. for the seminar sessions. Then on Saturday, we'll have plenary session 2, yes, that is from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, and the topic will be the gospel and technological revolution. Yes, the same goes for the second week, that is from 8, yes, from 8 November, session 5, seminar session 5, on 10th November, seminar session 6, yes, and on 1st to 25th November, the 25-day loop challenge, devotional for daily personal devotions. Yes. On to our last slide. Yes, that is the final summit. The final summit. Still on the program. Yes, thank you. Yes, we will be having a session, exposition 2 and exposition 3. There is interactive sessions of prayers. Plenary session 3, plenary 5, there's lunch break, then the last session, plenary session 6, a faithful witness in a dynamic world, then there is exposition 1, that is prayers, there's praise and prayers, then plenary 4, the gospel and environmental care. So as you can see, that program, it has very many sessions that you can attend in within the week. Yes, and it's not every day, it's Monday, Wednesday, Friday, then Saturday you have the session from 9 to 12. Yes, so it's very flexible. Yes, we are all of us are asked to attend. Welcome. Yes, on to our last slide. The last slide, the very last slide, yes. Welcome, register today. Yes, I have told you to register. You go to conferences.focuskenya.org, conferences.focuskenya.org. Yes, in case you are having problems with the registration, you can see me or the same staff, Mr. Andrew. Yes, for them in UAE, from my annex, can see Omedo from CHS, you can also see Omedo. Then Blessed is also around, then from my main, you can see her. And even the commission committee, I believe we have the commission committee in our different institutions. Yes, you can see the members from those committees, they help you with the registration. And I want to believe that all of us will be there, yes, to be transformed throughout the sessions. Thank you so much. I welcome Hossein.
Thank you so much. Not a thing. We're just coming to the tail end of this forum. It was so nice to have. Whom would we treat as the audience for this forum? If not you. Yeah, but I know someone else is going to be coming to grab that for us. So just like to take some feedback for the forum. We like to let it next time. And I know this was not an all perfect forum. So it's just to hear any comments that you could be having. Clarification, not necessarily not for the conference, but a clarification about the forum is on. Then where do you think we can improve going forward? And then also you can help us appreciate any possible areas that we can focus on when we organize for another script engagement one. Yes. Anyone who wants to go past a comment, maybe you've been blessed and you just want to share with us what the Lord has taught you this day. Yes.
I'm a member from Alex. I'm grateful for having a director at Blanco. But today I'm an alcoholic. The key of some of these comments, the key of the year, the key of the best is that what I have in mind that I did would be in form of group discussion. The key just an aspect of the of having some groups to discuss. Because even in terms of teacher engagement, it has been more of a teaching that has been beneficial to us. But then I also think that with time, there can be some form of group discussion for people to discuss some topics and to share the interests of the same. Then there can be a moderation after that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mom. That was good enough. Anyone else? Yes, my God. Please just tell us your name. One last one, yes, Eric.
Yes, thank you, sir. My name is Brian Embeck from Moyanex. So the session has been really exciting, encouraging, and educative, and personally I've really gained a lot in the same. So my suggestion for the areas I feel that we need to tackle, I will link term is controversial, but I think there are emerging trends. Mm-hmm. One is the LGBTQ issue, and then the second one, I think we can also delve more on the issue of prosperity gospel, and I think Yeah, because I feel the session was quite short. So I think possibly it really needs a lot of things. And then another one would be the issue of atheism. I think it's really creeping in our institutions, and it's something that can be dealt with. And then lastly is about how to engage the issues of Islam and other religions. I think that is something that you can try and tackle. And always, I'm so grateful. Thank you.
So you mean engaging other faith?
Yeah.
Oh. Thank you. We will close it at that. I know we are gender balanced. I do not have a sister who feels like they want to say something. But if there is none, then that's fine. Thank you. So I would like to invite the architecture to come and wrap it up for us. Yeah, in case you have any questions regarding the forum that you've had, please share it on 0724-997-058. We will see how that can be responded to. Yes. And then, or you can ask, you can raise it through your direct staff.
Yeah, and you can see that at least we were targeting the discipleship docket and their committee. And we are saying this, that would you want to pick this and run with it? So that you don't have to wait for, you know, Peter to come and say, now we have another forum. So what we are saying is that as you're planning for your next academic, spiritual year, would you consider one of the semesters to just pick a weekend and have it as a scripture engagement weekend? And then we contextualize that to issues that the CU is facing. So if the CU is facing issues about speaking in tongues, then we organize topics around that area. We get speakers for the same. So we are basically saying this, that if you want to see this in your CUs, then just get in touch with the staff who is working directly with you, so that we are able to, and would really, really love if we adopt this as an annual event in our CUs. Otherwise, thank you. God bless you.
Okay, praise the Lord. Praise God again.
Coffee somewhere here. Yes, so please don't go without taking coffee. Yes, we also have some accompaniment. Yes, that is me.
Thank you so much. So my name is Osengo. I come from OCHS. I'm glad to be here. I don't know if you guys have been blessed. Personally, I'm so blessed. I've been encouraged, inspired, also challenged. So I want to thank all the people that have made this a success. And first of all, I want to thank God for the divine enablement to be called here. So let's clap for God. Thank you so much. Next, we want to thank the Focus Northrift, including the staff, the CMF, the STEP staff, the ASEP, for organizing this and making it a success. Let's clap for them. Next, I want us to clap for our speakers who are not here with us. The first one was Mr. Ruben Kigama, the second one was Pastor Albert Nandi. Let's clap for them. Second, lastly, I want us to thank our hosts, UOE Christian Union, for allowing us to hold this forum here. And then lastly, I want us to clap for ourselves for being here today. That is all. At this point, I welcome my fellow leader, Elder, to come and make the final prayer, and then we follow the directions that you have given. Okay, thank you.
Let us bow for prayer. gather my father for your presence and receive kindness in your word. That Lord never gather your people in vain, O Lord God Almighty. We are grateful, my Father, for the wonderful station, O God, that you've had of your glory, O God. Just helping my Father, God, and dividing, my Father, your word, King of glory, O God, that my Father may be conformed to your perfect image, O Lord God Almighty. We are so grateful, O King of glory, O God, for the journey, mercy, O God, that you have called us, O Lord. Why do you have my Father, God, traveling here, King of glory, O God? We are grateful, my Father, for the host, King of glory, O God, for my Father, the hospitable environment that they have given us, O Lord. O God, may you receive all the glory, all the praise, and my Father, all the honor, Lord. We are grateful, my Father, even, O God, for focus, O Lord God Almighty. From my Father, the regional coordinator, the CMF, my Father, Lord, and King of Glory, and the staff, the RSEC officials, and all the my Father partners, use of God in this North Rift region, O Lord. May my Father remember each and every one of us, O God, according to your Lord, God Almighty. We are also grateful, my Father and my God, even King of Glory, God, for more platforms, O God, that are going to enable us, O God, to have King of Glory, God, that my Father may be conformed to your perfect image, all for the glory and the honor of your holy name, our Father. O God, we pray, my Father, even as we depart, O God, to our respective institutions, O God, that you shall make us, my Father, King of Glory, God, the light unto the dark world. That you shall make us, my Father, soul in King of Glory, God, Father, Lord. And you shall be of influence in our institutions for the glory and the honor of your name, O Father, Lord. Oh God, even my Father, for the refreshments, O God, ahead of us, O Lord. How we pray, my Father, that shall, my Father, God, be of nutrition of value to our health, all for the glory and the honor of your name. And these are prayer of faith in the name of God, the Father, the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Be in Christ.